Thanks, David. So in a room of, say, 1,000 people, maybe a little later in the day, there would be 100 of you out there who at some point in your life will have a seizure. And this can be a pretty terrifying experience. To give you some idea of what this might be like, I want to show you a video taken by a man named Tim Fry, and we can play the video. So he was just going for a routine ride in the park, and this is what happened. Right, I'll stop it there. So obviously he wasn't planning on this, and this just happened out of the blue. If this happened to you, you know, one of the main questions you would have is, will this happen again? The risk after one seizure that you'll have more if you don't get any testing is about 40%. But we have a way of predicting which patients are very likely to have more and which ones won't, and that's called the electroencephalogram, which David just told you about. And in an EEG. And in this test, we put wires on your head, and we record electrical signals from your brain. And so this is what I would see if I was reading one of those paper EEGs, or now a digital EEG. And you can see that it's kind of a mess of wavy lines, right? It's maybe not too familiar at first, but with some experience, about 6 years of experience, you can learn to recognize this. And this one jumps out at me immediately as an EEG from a patient who does have epilepsy. The telltale sign is if you look up right in the middle, in the top couple of rows, there's a very pointy waveform that we call an epileptic spike. And the way I introduce this to new trainees is if you see something that if you sat on it, it would hurt, that's probably an epileptic spike. Now, it's actually not that simple. It turns out that their spikes come in all different shapes, and this makes it pretty difficult. This is why it takes some years of experience and training to recognize them. So here, from 200 different patients, are examples of epileptic spikes ranging from very difficult to very easy on the bottom row. And discriminating these from normal elements of the background brain activity is where a lot of the challenge comes in and the potential for inaccurate diagnosis. Now, I'm fortunate to be part of a group here who reads EEGs, you know, as part of my living. So here I am looking at an EEG from a patient who's come into our epilepsy lab and describing the findings. And our group is able to give people accurate diagnoses, or at least we pride ourselves on that, and get people treatment. And chances are, if you're one of the patients who, you know, playing the odds, has epilepsy in this audience, and there probably are a few, and you're here, you know, there's no shortage of doctors in Boston, right, as you can see for yourself. So you probably, if you're here again, probably got an accurate diagnosis and are on appropriate treatment, and our treatments are quite effective, so most people who go through this process never have another seizure. Unfortunately, if you're not in Boston, say you're out in most communities, 75% of EEGs are read by non-specialists. They're neurologists, but no specialty training in epilepsy, which leads to frequent diagnoses that are wrong. Either, you know, a condition wasn't really epilepsy and you're on drugs for years, or the opposite, misdiagnoses. And worse than that, there are 50 million people in the world with epilepsy who never get, but 30 million of them never get diagnosed or treated. So there's this huge opportunity for treating people that we're missing. So obviously we can't just create more neurologists as easily as we want, or specialists, but we can try to train computers to do this automatically. Now, this is not a new idea. Here's a list of papers over the years of attempts to create automated spike detection algorithms, but they're all flawed. And I want to just highlight one of the best papers, I think, and show you some of the problems. So this paper, just a couple of years ago, was from a company named Persist, and their algorithm P13, they claimed had passed the Turing test, meaning it could identify epileptic spikes as well as experts. But when you look at the paper, it's not convincing. They tested their algorithm on just 40 patients. These were patients who were undergoing evaluation for epilepsy surgery. So they had very frequent spikes. If you like, they were relatively easy. And they compared their algorithm to non-specialists, right, because it was too difficult to get specialists to score the spikes the way they would need to. So this doesn't really, if you had to bet on this, you'd bet it wouldn't generalize, and in fact, nobody really relies on this, we still read these things manually. So we set out to do, to actually create something that would pass the Turing test. So we managed over the last 5 years to collect more than 1,000 EEGs, 88,000 spikes, and to have, these are from not just special patients, but from everyone who comes into the MGH epilepsy lab for diagnostic testing. And we managed to get 7 subspecialty trained experts to score these discharges. So I want to give you some sense of what they scored, and the one of the problems, they don't all agree. So here's an example of a EEG where 1 out of 7 experts said there's a spike on this page, and you can it's up in the top couple of leads there. Here's a more convincing one. If you look at the bottom, there is in fact something a little bit sharp there, and 4 out of 7 agreed that this was an epileptic spike. And then here's one, the one I showed you earlier, where that everyone agrees up at the top is very spiky. This would only be seen in a patient with epilepsy. So before you can train a computer, you first need to know how well humans can do. And here's the summary. So on the bottom, on the x-axis, we've grouped the spikes according to how many experts voted for them, from 0 to 7. And then on the y-axis, we have a curve for each expert showing kind of what proportion of those examples that expert voted for. And you can see there's some variability. There's the curve that goes up is someone who overcalls relative to the consensus, and the one underneath is an undercaller. And these are all colleagues, and really I respect their abilities, but you can see there's be some variation. So if you were the patient, what you would most like is to have your EEG interpreted by 7 neurologists, right? 7 epileptic, and have that crowdsourced and discussed and come to the kind of the truth in the middle. Now, your insurance won't pay for you to see 7 specialists at once, probably, but we can get a computer to do this. And so here's the result of our, what we call the super spike detector. It essentially is like crowdsourcing your EEG. It's right along the diagonal in terms of its predictions. Now, it turns out that what you really want is not any one spike to be, you know, agreed upon, but you want the whole EEG to be classified as either consistent with epilepsy or not. And so we've got, this is the ROC curve for our super spike detector. Just for reference, it's known about where a typical neurologist, and again, this incorporates some of the noise that I just showed you, typical, you know, subspecialty trained epileptologist can read an EEG and predict with a 87% sensitivity and a 60% false positive rate whether you have epilepsy based on the EEG. If you could do this with exactly the same sensitivity, which you can with our super spike detector, you'll get a false positive rate of 10%, right, just moving over onto the ROC curve. And what this translates into when you take into account the pretest probability is going from sort of the percent of, you know, positive EEGs that are true goes from 60 to 87%. And among those that you say, oh, this is normal, does not have epilepsy, that goes from 80 to 91%, so a big improvement. So in the future, when someone like Tim comes in, after having an event thought to be a seizure, we won't have to wait several weeks to get the EEG read, maybe by a non-specialist or by a specialist who might disagree with his or her colleagues, but instead we'll be able to have the EEG rapidly read by the equivalent of a group of epileptologists much more quickly get someone like Tim to appropriate treatment. So we've, just to summarize, we have the largest set of training data ever assembled for a machine learning algorithm to detect epileptic spikes. It works remarkably well, better than any individual human. And the next steps are FDA approval. We're incorporating this into a low-cost, no expertise needed device, and we are seeking funding partners to develop it further. So I'm happy to talk to people in the back afterward, and thanks for listening.